Welcome to Senior Care Insights. I'm Dr. Deborah Moerland, your host. I also own First Light Home Care, and today I have several people I will be interviewing, including Dr. Ronald Bishop, Marcy Rzepka, and Jack Weyers. First of all, we have Dr. Bishop. He is a board-certified emergency physician with 40 years of experience in emergency care, family medicine, and urgent medicine. He teaches at Michigan State University at the College of Osteopathic Medicine and is an associate professor at the college. Dr. Bishop currently sits on the board of Osteopathic Medical Examiners and Surgeons for the state of Michigan. And last year, in 2022, he was chosen as the top doctor in the state of Michigan. He's also an active board member for Owosso Memorial Hospital, which is where he currently works as an emergency room doctor. So welcome, Dr. Bishop. How are you today?
Thank you, Deb. I am doing well, and thank you for this opportunity.
Oh, well, thank you for joining us. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about dementia, and with your expertise, I think this is a great topic. So do you want to go over some of the beginning signs of dementia for our audience?
Yes, the most important factor is to be aware of the early warning signs of dementia. And those warning signs are just forgetting simple things, simple tasks, not being able to remember names, not being able to remember birthdays. Those are sometimes the early subtle signs of the onset of dementia. The thing that's really important is that dementia is a disease with what we consider an insidious onset, meaning that it is very, very slow in its progression in the beginning, and then it develops into early dementia, which can sometimes also go into what we call Alzheimer's disease. The importance of recognition is to notify your primary care physician of your concerns and being very open and honest with your primary care provider about your concerns. There are several testing that can be performed to actually diagnose you early in the disease process. And these usually include a referral to a neurologist who specializes in dementia, and they will do several testing to give you an adequate diagnosis and also recommend certain type medications to get started to delay the onset of the disease. The thing that's important to also recognize is the medications are designed to slow the progress of the disease. And to this time and date and time, we have not found a cure for dementia and Alzheimer's.
Yeah, correct. So what should someone do? What approach do you think they should take if they think they have dementia?
Well, the first thing you should do is have a talk with your family members. And I think that's a huge, huge process. The other process is to get a hold of your primary care physician, whomever that may be. And that's the gatekeeper to your healthcare. And that individual can direct you into getting a referral to a neurologist who specializes in memory care. And once that referral occurs, then the process of making a diagnosis is started. And then from that information, that's how the medications are prescribed by the neurologist and maintained by the primary care physician.
I know a lot of people are in denial that they have dementia. So I think many times the actual person may not think they have dementia, but the family members could also do the same and try to convince them to go to their primary physician. But how do you think a family member should approach someone who they feel has dementia?
Well, the first is to fill out the individual to see where they are and meet them where they are. If someone is in denial of their obvious disease process, there's little that can be done initially. The other thing that you can do is start to get services that you provide to sometimes bring individuals in the home to help with cooking, daily tasks, traveling, driving, all of those things. So if you can take those things away from them, you can keep them safe. And I think that's the whole goal in the individual who is in denial, is their safety, their individual safety, because these people will start to cook and forget that the stove is on and can cause a fire. Later on in the disease processes, they can get in their car and drive and get lost and can't find their way home. And even in the latter stages of the disease, some individuals will be wandering in the neighborhood and get lost and can't find their way home. So those are things that they can do to try to alleviate the obvious in the denial process. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And when should someone really stop driving if they have dementia? Should it be immediately, or are they able to drive a little bit, or what would you suggest?
Well, if you're driving and you've got two or three accidents and you don't know how they happen, then I think you should stop driving immediately. The other process is to go to the Division of Motor Vehicles and take a driving test. And that individual can be evaluated as to whether or not they're competent to continue to drive. Because you have to remember, a car is a weapon.
Definitely.
So we have to be cognizant of that and your reaction time. And the Department of Motor Vehicles can actually evaluate your reaction time and make a decision on whether you're competent or not to continue to drive.
Okay. Yeah, I know I've had some clients in the past, and it takes a lot to get people to give up their driving, especially. They don't want to lose their independence. However, to keep them safe as well as the community, they need to consider giving it up as soon as possible and, you know, use family members or a service to get them where they need to go. But so if a family member doesn't want a loved one to drive, can they just report that to them? Department of Motor Vehicles, and they'll schedule a test, or?
Well, they can report it to the DMV. Sometimes they can intervene. The other thing is you can disable the car.
Mm. Right.
I've seen that happen.
Yeah. This is kind of a funny story, but I had a client about 5 or 6 years ago, and the family, you know, took away the keys, and she decided to have her car towed to the dealership and get new keys made for it somehow. And then, unfortunately, she ended up in a very, she didn't end up in an accident per se, but she was out driving on ice and came back home and fell on the ice, and then she never could go back home. So people need to think about their overall safety as well, and when they should be going in and out and things like that. So it was just, she just had it in her mind. It didn't matter. She could remember how to do that, but, you know, she was getting lost all the time. So what approach how should someone plan once they have a diagnosis? So looking down the road, it's very good to plan ahead. Even though their dementia may not be very bad, people tend to put things off. But what are some things that they should be planning for?
One, they should be planning for their care moving forward as the disease progresses. The second thing they should do is get their affairs in order while they're in their right mind, meaning the DPOA, who will make decisions for you when you cannot no longer make decisions? What do you want as far as your funeral arrangements, whether you want a funeral or not funeral, whether you want to be cremated or buried? you also want to talk about your business aspects of what you want as far as your financial aspects and who you want your financial assets to go to. What do you want done with your home and all your assets? Those are all things that I think are important to have discussions about when you're in your right mind. Once the disease has taken over and you're reached the latter aspects of Alzheimer's, you're unable to communicate. And that creates a huge, huge obstacle for your family members or your caregivers.
Yes, it does. And if it's not written out, people make the decisions for you and you don't really know what they might decide for you. So it's best to plan ahead. So I hear you have a book coming out soon. And when is that going to be released? And can you give us a little bit of information about that?
Absolutely. I have, for the last 5 years, been thinking about writing a book. And the name of the book is Life One Breath Away. And this is actually a memoir of my life growing up in Birmingham, Alabama, in the segregated town of Fairfield, Alabama, and basically been pushed around in my family and growing up in the segregated area of Alabama, and then being forced into integration in high school, and then going to college and experiencing some bias and racial inequality in the institution of my own race, and managed to go to medical school. And I talk about my interests and my experiences in medical school. But I also talk about my experiences of 40 years being in the emergency department, where I have experienced multiple individuals who have passed away. And what I realized in that experience is that when we die, you take one breath. And after that one breath, there's a calm. And it almost feels like it's something leaves your body, a spirit leaves your body, and it travels elsewhere. And I talk about that experience. And I also talk about the experience of birth, of when you are born, when you come through the birth canal, the first thing we do as physicians is look for that first breath. And that first breath is the beginning of your dash to the end of your last breath. And I also talk about Alzheimer's in my book. I talk about the importance of health and health maintenance and the importance of having a primary care physician early on in your life so that you have a blueprint for your health for comparison's sake. The book also talks about my life and the experiences that I've had with personal experiences with depression. I talk about some of my health issues of being a prostate cancer survivor and having two back surgeries and the repercussions of having that and being depressed and coming out of it and being able to work and become productive. So this book is quite comprehensive. My hope is that they will read the book and be inspired that you can do anything that you want when you put your mind to it. Mm-hmm. My reason for writing the book was I wanted to be a doctor since I was at the age of 5 after having a conversation with my father, who wasn't able to go to college. And he always wanted to be a doctor, so I decided that I would pursue that avenue in his honor. And having lost my father, I know he's in heaven smiling down on me as a result of the success that I have made. So that's the essence of the book. And my hope is it's coming out the end of October, first part of November. We are in the process of the editing and the cover. And I don't think we're far away.
That's awesome. I'm looking forward to reading it myself. So repeat the name of that book again so people know.
Life One Breath Away.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Bishop. Our next guest is going to be Marcy Rzepka. And We're ready for a break.
The friendship, the closeness that two people can have.
My caretaker, it just does everything I ask it to do.
Motivates me to the extent that I know that I can live another day.
She's my transportation. When we shop, groceries, she fixes my hair for me. And she makes it lunch, she makes supper, she just ordinarily is a companion. And she walks the dog, which is wonderful. And so she's a lovely companion.
I love her. She's fantastic. And she's doing a good job.
Time is valuable, especially when it comes to caring for a loved one. Instead of spending your day juggling caregiving tasks, you could actually spend quality time with your family, enjoying the memories, playing games, catching up on work, or simply relaxing and getting recharged. A client review stated, "We used First Light Services to care for my mom for almost 3 years in her home. We were very lucky to find such loving and compassionate caregivers. They were knowledgeable about mom's issues and truly cared about her well-being, as well as helping the family learn how to adapt to her changes. Our caregivers are professionally trained, background checked, must pass a drug test, and are compassionate. We offer flexible plans tailored to meet your family's needs, ensuring that you get time back in your day without compromising the quality of care. Don't let another day slip away being a caregiver. Make the call today and let First Light Home Care of Greater Lansing illuminate the pathway to exceptional home care and give you back the gift of time." Welcome back to Senior Care Insights. Our next guest is Marcy Rzepka. She's an MSU telecommunications graduate with over 3 decades of experience in sales. She has a remarkable story of resilience and compassion. In 2015, she faced a personal tragedy, though, losing her beloved brother and best friend, Mark. And then the same year, shortly after, she found out that she had kidney disease. These unfortunate experiences have led to the creation of the Mark Advocacy Group, a 501c3 nonprofit established in 2021. This organization that she runs provides vital support to individuals with kidney disease and diabetes. And in her role as a senior member relations manager at the Lansing Regional Chamber of Commerce, Marcy also continues to empower individuals and businesses in her community. When she isn't working, though, she enjoys time with her family, friends, her dog, Ruxin, and cat, Mabel, and she likes writing poetry and singing. Her journey is a testament to her unwavering commitment to helping others. So, Marcy, how are you doing today?
I'm doing fantastic. How about you, Deb?
I'm doing great. I'm doing really great. So, you want to go into why did you start MARC, the MARC Advocacy Group?
Sure. And thanks for having me. So, my brother had a lot of autoimmune diseases when he was young. He was sick all the time. And back then, they didn't really look into autoimmune diseases. So as he got older, obviously, my parents took care of him. As he got older, though, I stepped in. And as being such a close sister and him being my best friend, I stepped in as an advocate for him. So I went to many of his appointments. And through this journey, I got to see how people are treated based on the opinions of the healthcare industry that is formed with the patient. So, for example, my brother had to have a double hip replacement surgery in his early 30s because we have a degenerative arthritic disease that runs in my family. So he got put on a lot of opiates during that crisis. And then he had a lot of pain. We took him back in and they just thought, here's this young man who wants to have, you know, more drugs, when actually it was an infection in the hip. And had I not been there, it probably could have been a completely different scenario. And I realized how important it was not only to have your own voice, but to have someone that could back up your voice if yours wasn't heard. So from that point forward, I moved forward with him, going to most of his appointments. I was the person that could contact if he couldn't, along with my mom at that time. And I realized that this was a very important thing that people needed. And as I started paying attention, I saw how people didn't have someone to go along with them. And then when Mark got a little more sick, my mom and I were still his advocates, and then we lost him unexpectedly. He got an infection and he got sepsis and passed away in his home. And then 6 weeks later, I got diagnosed with stage 3 kidney disease. And as I started going through the process, again, acting as my own advocate, I realized I would see how many people would come to these appointments alone who couldn't drive. They would ride a bus. They would, you know, go home after a procedure alone. Recently, in the last year and a half, I went through the transplant program. And as I was in there getting a procedure where I had to be put under, the woman next to me was getting the same procedure. My driver got given my outpatient instructions, whereas this woman was in her 70s and had taken a bus there and was then having to take a bus home, listen to her own outpatient instructions. And I just realized, you know, that this isn't something that should be happening. Everyone deserves to have someone go along with them and not just taking them to and from appointments, but, you know, taking notes, picking up scripts. We will be offering different types of training programs. So it's just once I realized what a gap there was for people who, you know, just to have someone embrace them in this situation where they are, I decided to launch this after my brother's name.
Oh, that's really good. We see that happen a lot with people too, where they don't, if they do get a ride, they're being dropped off and not having someone to stay with them. And a lot of times they don't even know what's going on, and it's good to have a second person there. So that's really good. So what is your vision for that Mark advocates can impact in the community?
So we're going to try and do this a little bit different. We were discussing this with my board the other day, and we decided that we want to be a nonprofit that people actually pattern themselves after. So what we are doing is we're, instead of just offering the rides to and from, sitting there with them, we're not, you know, we're not going to be hiring bus drivers. We're going to be hiring people who are going to go in, take notes. We will supply them with a notebook that will be just for that patient. We will match patient experiences with advocate experiences. They will all be background checked, much as you do. They will also have to go through a series of training. My personal nephrologist will be on the training committee, teaching them from a doctor's perspective what kind of questions are important for them to ask that will get right to the point in the meat of why you're there and what is necessary to know and lead with. They will also be trained by myself and other people who have gone through as the patient, saying, here's what's important that you catch that I might miss, because sometimes you're overwhelmed as the patient and you're only grasping what little you can. And there might be small things that you may just kind of pass over in your mind, but really matter. So having someone else to capture those, that information is really important. They will also, we're going to be offering our advocates meditation and yoga, because this is very stressful. Caregivers often take on the brunt. I'm my own caregiver. There's times I need to do meditation and yoga for my own self, but because I have to deal with myself. But it's we're going to, they can be a part of Medicare and Medicaid training seminars we're going to hold so that they can remember the information if the patient comes up with questions, Blue Cross Blue Shield billing codes, things like that. So our advocates are going to be trained in a different way than most. It's not just, you know, please come in and volunteer to do this. And then, you know, we want to keep them long term. Longevity is important in anything, and that consistency. And just like in your business, where they love to have that same person come to see them, having the same person to walk through the journey with them is most important. And that's what we plan on making happen at the Market Advocacy Group.
That's really a good thing because it can develop that relationship with that person, and you know, they'll feel much better about having someone go along too once they get to know them. So how can people get involved and be an advocate?
Sure. So we you can go to markadvocacygroup.org, and we have applications there for people to fill out on our website. And then what they do from there is there'll be a part in there where they can give a little bit about not disclosing a lot of personal information, but saying, I prefer to work with someone with diabetes, or I prefer to work with someone who has kidney disease. It may be because they had a family member. It may be we've got some advocates that have gone through the kidney transplant journey. So they're going to be able to know firsthand. So they might say, I prefer to work with someone with kidney disease. We've got people who have diabetes currently that are advocates. It's really, we'll meet people where they are. So if they want to be with someone who's just being diagnosed, if they want to be with someone who's been in the journey and feels like they've been left behind, we're going to kind of align it the best way, you know, that we can actually kind of fit personalities and backgrounds together. So you go to our website, again, markadvocacy.org or at markadvocygroup.org. You fill out the application, and then the training process begins. We have an interview process. You do a background check, and then once all those have passed and we go through the interview phase, then we start the training process and bring you on board.
And how long does that take typically?
So it's going to depend on the person and their time. So what we're trying to do is we will have in-person training sessions, and then we will have, if they can't make it, we will have sessions that will be offered online as well. So typically a lot of it's going to depend on, I believe it's like a couple of weeks before you can get back the background check. Sometimes that's the holdup. So we're hoping that the whole process, that we can get people started within like a 6 to 8 week window.
Okay. In terms of being a nonprofit, how do you get funded, and what are ways that people in the community can help your group?
Sure. So obviously we have a donate button. They can go to our website and donate there, or they can come to some of the events we put on. This year, we did a golf outing. In June, we did a walk with another nonprofit. Next year, we are going to be doing a walk again with this other nonprofit in the spring. We have to determine the date yet. We will also be doing the golf outing June 13th at Grosbeck Golf Course for the Mark Advocacy Group. And we will also be taking over and bringing back the chili cook-off that was in the Lansing area until 2020. We'll be doing that again with another nonprofit with the help of Lansing Board of Water and Light. And that date's going to be September 28th. So they can come to any of these events. You can sponsor an event. You can play golf. You can walk with us. You can donate. You can come eat some chili. You can do any of those things. We also are working on, and we have currently at a bar in town called the Lansing Shuffle, we have a charity tap that they kindly donated because the owner's sister had passed away from kidney disease. They have three different types of beers that are rotating through this charity tap. It does not have my name on it. It's just a charity tap, but they can do the QR code, go right to our site and donate, or 50% of any beer that is bought off that tap comes back to our group. So we're trying to find different ways to get people involved. But truly, if you didn't want to come to any events or do anything like that, you could just go online and donate.
Okay. And in terms of referring people who have kidney disease or diabetes, how would somebody go about doing that? And are there any criteria specific for that? Or can anybody that's been diagnosed just be receive some help from you guys?
Sure. We don't have a certain stage. Clearly, people with diabetes, obviously type 1, they're born with it. Type 2, people will typically get exposed to that based on diet and kind of how their exercise type of stuff is, if there's hereditary things, but it doesn't matter what stage they're in. We like to help people who have type 2 diabetes, because oftentimes the amazing thing I have found is that with simple diet changes, oftentimes that can be reversed. Most people who come to us with kidney disease are going to be in the stage three or stage four level, sometimes even stage five, because you don't typically get diagnosed until stage three, because there's really, it's a pretty symptom-free disease. You don't know, it's a silent disease. One in three people are at a risk of having kidney disease. They may have it and not even know it, because again, there just aren't a lot of symptoms. So unless you go and ask for that panel of blood work to be pulled to check your kidneys constantly, then you probably aren't going to know. But no, there is no stage that we will not help. Even if someone comes on and says we're pre-diabetic, we're running into issues, and you know, we're already starting to experience some health issues. We'll take them on and help them at that point, because not always is it about going to a doctor. Sometimes we're going to be working with a couple of ladies who have delivery services for food, and we'll be selling those online so people can kind of change their diets and see how that works. So improving your health can start at any stage in your life.
Oh, definitely it can. It might just take a few little changes and it can make a huge difference in your life. Sure. So,
and having someone to encourage you and to do that and to know that you're not alone, will also offer support groups of people who are in my position waiting to get a transplant, or have, you know, they're a donor and they have questions. They want to know what's going to happen, or they're caregivers, or we simply are going to have just like a community forum where our patients can talk to each other if they so, you know, choose to do so.
Okay. And are there specific symptoms that are noticeable in the beginning at all for some people?
So I think some of the things that, looking back, now if I think about the symptoms that I had, was I started to get really tired very easily. And without knowing it then, I was very, very dehydrated and my hands would cramp a lot. So I had that going on, and I didn't drink a lot of water at that time. So I kind of chalked it up to that. But those are some of the early symptoms that you will see. Obviously, if you start having issues with, you know, discoloration in your eyes, or, you know, all of a sudden you have a lot of edema going on, definitely you need to get in somewhere, because that'll happen. I did have that too, where I would bloat up in my lower legs and I couldn't figure out what was happening. By the time I was paying attention to being so tired, I had just lost my brother, so I figured it was just the grief that was taking that on. And I'm sure part of that was once I got diagnosed, but those would probably be the symptoms I would pay attention to. So if you're extremely thirsty, if all of a sudden you have issues that you're going to the bathroom either too much or not enough, those are symptoms. Cramping, bloating, edema, those are some of the symptoms I would look for early on.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for being on our show.
Absolutely.
You've given us a lot of information, and I hope some more people will get involved with your mission. And thank you again.
Thank you, Deb. Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.
The friendship, the closeness that two people can have.
My caretaker, it just does everything I ask it to do.
Motivates me to the extent that I know that I can live another day.
She's my transportation. When we shop, groceries, she fixes my hair for me. And she makes her lunch, she makes supper. She just ordinarily is a companion. And she walks the dog, which is wonderful. And so she's a lovely companion.
I love her. She's fantastic. And she's doing a good job.
Time is valuable, especially when it comes to caring for a loved one. Instead of spending your day juggling caregiving tasks, you could actually spend quality time with your family, enjoying the memories, playing games, catching up on work, or simply relaxing and getting recharged. A client review stated, "We used First Light Services to care for my mom for almost 3 years in her home. We were very lucky to find such loving and compassionate caregivers. They were knowledgeable about mom's issues and truly cared about her well-being, as well as helping the family learn how to adapt to her changes. Our caregivers are professionally trained, background checked, must pass a drug test, and are compassionate. We offer flexible plans tailored to meet your family's needs, ensuring that you get time back in your day without compromising the quality of care. Don't let another day slip away being a caregiver. Make the call today and let First Light Home Care of Greater Lansing illuminate the pathway to exceptional home care and give you back the gift of time. Good afternoon. Welcome, Jack.
How are you doing, Deb?
Doing great.
Good to see you.
Yeah, great to see you again. All right. We have Howard J. Weyers, a.k.a. Jack, from the Family and Elder Law of Mid-Michigan. And he's going to be speaking to us today about powers of attorney. So after nearly 25 years of it being in the employee benefit industry, Jack decided to go back to school to pursue his dream of becoming an attorney. Coincidentally, he had the privilege of being a primary caregiver for his mother as well, who struggled with Alzheimer's disease. All of these experiences occurred at or around the same time to inspire him to pursue a career in the area of estate planning and elder law to help families plan for and endure in times of need. So could you tell us about a significant moment and or experience that inspired your strong commitment to helping families dealing with various illnesses?
Yeah, sure can, Deb. It's kind of a real confluence of things that happened all at once. But I decided to go back to law school at a very old age. And when I did that, you have to take a law school entrance exam. So I had talked to some people that I knew were practicing law, and they had visions of me entering practice with them in the gaming law area. So it's very different than what I'm doing today. So you take a test called the LSAT, which is the law school entrance exam. The day after I took that exam, my mom was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. So I was still going to go down the original path. But as you mentioned before, Deb, I was one of her primary caregivers. And as we went through that process, I would take mom out, try to keep her engaged as much as I could. And one of the things I did was take her to a local memory care facility, because they did gardening there and it was somewhere I could take her where she could garden and be safe, that we didn't have to worry about her wandering off. And while I was there, I just watched, just kind of observed the other folks that were at the nursing home. And there were folks that were there all alone and their family never visited them. Mm-hmm. There were folks where you heard the families, just fretting about how they were going to pay for care and continue to pay for care. And then the worst ones where you'd hear the people sitting around waiting for, wondering if grandma was going to die in time, that they'd still get some money. So, you saw the really good and the really bad there. And that experience really inspired me to give up the gaming law piece and become an elder law attorney. So that's really what got me here. And that's what kind of fuels my passion on a daily basis.
Okay. Well, today we're going to talk about the importance of powers of attorney.
Yeah.
And so can you explain what are powers of attorney?
So powers of attorney can cover a pretty broad area, but we always kind of refer to it as above ground planning. So it's the planning that you do if you're above ground, so you're still alive, but you're not well. So what would happen if you became incapacitated? Who could make various decisions for you and act on your behalf? So there are really a couple areas of concern that we really want to address. And if you don't address it yourself, the court system in our state, in Michigan and most states, has a resolution too. But most people don't want the state making decisions for them and creating the rules for which their care would be provided and how their money might be spent to provide that care. So there are really two primary documents that we use. One's called a patient advocate designation. Some people call it a healthcare power of attorney or a medical power of attorney or a healthcare proxy. And it's a document where you name the person who can make your healthcare decisions for you if you can't. The other document we use, we refer to it as a durable power of attorney, and that is the document that allows people to make financial and legal decisions for you when you can't make them for yourself.
Okay. So what powers of attorney are needed? Are both of these needed, and why are they needed?
Well, so again, as I said, the reason that they're different is because they're different in the law. So in Michigan, you may have heard of legal proceedings called guardianship and conservatorship. A guardianship is if somebody hasn't executed powers of attorney, and they can no longer make decisions regarding their care, custody, medical, and mental health treatment, someone has to go to the court and petition to become their guardian. Oftentimes the state does this, sometimes family members. A patient advocate designation in Michigan, that's how it's encoded in the law, is a document that allows you to appoint a patient advocate and their successors if they can't act, because sometimes your agent may not be able to act. So we try to build some depth into that document and to create rules as it relates to your care, custody, medical, and mental health treatment to give them direction. Some people have heard the term advanced directives or medical directives. So if there's a grant of legal authority that gives someone the authority to make those decisions for you, and then you can provide direction or instructions in that document so they know how you want to be cared for. So in short, as it relates to your health care, you get to appoint, you get to choose the people who will act for you rather than the court making that decision, and you get to decide the rules they play by rather than a judge making those decisions for you. So that relates to the healthcare piece, and it's a separate document. And the other document, as I said before, is a durable power of attorney. And that's would you name someone to act to make legal and financial decisions for you if you're incapacitated. So who pays the bills? These can be two different people. You can have a patient advocate that's different from your power of attorney. And oftentimes people like those kind of checks and balances, or they want to, you know, split up the duties, because sometimes these aren't the most fun jobs, and you have other people questioning the decisions you're making and things like that. But we try to do the same thing in that document, as we provide direction as to how we want our money spent. And, you know, together those things are, you have the person who can arrange for your care, and then the other person who arranges for payment of your care and make sure all your other bills get paid.
Okay. So who basically needs a power of attorney?
Well, interestingly, and this is one that people forget, and it doesn't necessarily relate to seniors, is really everyone over the age of 18 should have powers of attorney. And there's a couple different scenarios that you might think of, but if you send a child off to college, they get in a car wreck and they're injured, you as your parent, once they're 18, they're an adult, you as their parent no longer have legal authority to make decisions for them as it relates to their health care. So we always say everybody who's reached the age of 18 should have at least a patient advocate designation, if not a financial power of attorney. So really everybody needs them. So there's kind of that piece, is every adult, if they want to make the decision as to who's going to make those decisions for them, should have powers of attorney. And the other thing is kind of a public, you know, kind of a public duty to do these things, because if you don't do it, you're going to tie up the court system. A judge and the court's resources, when you could have taken action yourself to make these decisions and not put the burden on the court system to do so.
Right. And the court isn't necessarily going to make the decisions that you want.
That's very true. So one of the things that we've seen recently, and it is a little bit troubling, but I was just actually sending out an email here earlier to a gentleman who he's concerned that his stepmother isn't caring for his dad the way that he would like to see his dad be treated. So, and we don't know if she has power of attorney, but he asked if he should go to court and apply for guardianship or conservatorship. And I said, the risk that you run there is stepmom as wife will have statutory priority to act as dad's guardian and conservator. But son, if son can show that she's maybe not acting in his best interest, the judge may not pick the son automatically to be guardian and conservator, because oftentimes judges who get elected don't want to make that call. And the easy call for them to make is to appoint a public administrator. And that's when you see, and I mean, some of you may see seen the show I Really Care on Netflix, where you see public people, public administrators or private people acting as professional guardians and conservators, acting in those roles. So you've got somebody who's in charge of your health care and your money who you don't even know.
Okay.
So it's a bit risky, and most people don't want
to. It sounds like it. It sounds very risky.
Yeah. So, in fact, recently there was a Court of Appeals case here in Michigan where the Court of Appeals admonished a probate judge because he was doing this kind of, it became his standard of practice is when people came in, he would just appoint public guardians rather than appoint family members, even when the family members wanted to be the guardian. So it's just doing the powers of attorney is just a way to for you to take control and for you to make the decisions rather than, you know, leaving that up to the state or the court.
What specific decisions can all be made in a power of attorney in terms of healthcare?
So we have what we call basic documents. And so a basic, for example, a basic patient advocate designation. In my case, I, Jack Weyers, appoint my wife, Becky Weyers, to make healthcare decisions when two doctors have certified that I'm no longer able to participate in my own healthcare decisions. If Becky can't do it, my buddy Mike is next. If Mike can't do it, my sister's next. So we build that kind of flexibility into the document. So that's the first decision you make. And we think you ought to make that, you know, with some forethought. You want people to be able to carry out your wishes. In that basic document, there's generally a section that gives you one of three choices as it relates to end of life. So the first choice would be, if I'm in a coma or irreversible vegetative state with no hope of recovery, if life-sustaining treatment would only artificially delay my death, or the burdens of treatment, in my patient advocate's opinion, outweigh the benefits of treatment, please cease all life-sustaining treatment and let me die naturally while relieving me of pain and keeping me comfortable. So that would be choice one. There's a second choice that just says, if I'm in a coma or irreversible vegetative state, stop life-sustaining treatment. And then the third choice is keep me alive no matter what. So that would be in a basic document. In an enhanced document, we would put directions as to different things. You want family there to pray with you, what kind of music you want to have played while you're at the hospital, do you want to be taken outside before you pass away? All those sorts of things. We can put direction as it relates to organ donation, donating your body to science, you know, how you want to be remembered. If you're in a long-term care situation, we create another document called a personal care plan. And that's just how you want to be treated on a day-to-day basis. Mine says, give me two cups of black coffee before 10 a.m., this is the kind of music I like. This is the kind of music I really don't like. I'm spiritual. So, you know, please expose me to spiritual situations when you can. I want to be taken outside a couple times a day, unless it's a blizzard or rains all day like it did here today. You know, don't feed me liver because my grandpa used to make me eat it all day, and don't feed me shrimp because it'll kill me. So we can be that detailed. And, you know, in your job, you know, so oftentimes you've got people you're caring for that can't really express how they want to be cared for. And if we can provide an instruction manual, it makes everybody's job easier, creates peace of mind, and hopefully prevents family fights when people start questioning as you know, the patient advocate on why they're providing treatment the way they are.
Okay.
So that's something we do in the healthcare. The financial power is a little bit less, you know, flexible. There's kind of more legalese in that document. But some of the things we do there is we integrate the financial power of attorney with the rest of an estate plan, so that we're coordinating the actions of the patient advocate with the financial power of attorney to make sure care is paid for appropriately. If you're a business owner, who can run your business, because that may not be the family member that you choose as your financial power of attorney. We put all the powers that would be needed in that document to and direction as to how we might protect assets if we were in a very long-term situation that might bankrupt the family, where we could try to qualify them for Medicaid and Medicare benefits if needed.
So how would someone go about getting powers of attorney completed?
Well, there's a lot of, you know, ways you can do it. You can go online and find them. I don't necessarily recommend that because maybe I'm being a little selfish in that regard, but I think there's some counseling that goes into that, to the process. So in some thought, you know, oftentimes we see people just name their kids the oldest to youngest, and then they end up with the wrong agent. They maybe haven't thought through the decision-making process. So, you know, the easy answer there is come see a lawyer, come see an estate planning or elder law attorney, preferably somebody that does elder law, and have them, you know, just have these discussions about what you want to have happen, what you don't want to have happen, and who the right people are to make those decisions for you.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for joining us today on Senior Care Insights. Your information was very valuable. I'm sure a lot of people don't realize everything that can be done using a power of attorney. And hopefully it saves some people some peace of mind, and I'll get in touch with you if they have any questions at all.
All right. Thanks, Deb. Appreciate you having me here.
Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Time is valuable, especially when it comes to caring for a loved one. Instead of spending your day juggling caregiving tasks, you could actually spend quality time with your family, enjoying the memories, playing games, catching up on work, or simply relaxing and getting recharged. A client review stated, "We used First Light Services to care for my mom for almost 3 years in her home. We were very lucky to find such loving and compassionate caregivers. They were knowledgeable about mom's issues and truly cared about her well-being, as well as helping the family learn how to adapt to her changes. Our caregivers are professionally trained, background checked, must pass a drug test, and are compassionate. We offer flexible plans tailored to meet your family's needs, ensuring that you get time back in your day without compromising the quality of care. Don't let another day slip away being a caregiver. Make the call today and let First Light Home Care of Greater Lansing illuminate the pathway to exceptional home care and give you back the gift of time."
We had some excellent interviews today with Ronald Bishop, doctor at Owosso Memorial Hospital. We also spoke to Marcy Rzepka and the Mark Advocacy Group, and Jack Weyers from Family and Elder Law, Mid-Michigan. I hope you found our podcast today very interesting and helpful for you as you navigate senior care. Please join us again on our next show as we have more valuable information available to share with our community. Thank you, and have a wonderful day.